drown in the moonlight. We collide in plain sight. Yeah, I know we'll be alright. And we come alive, we run the night with strangers. Cause in the end we're all familiar faces. We young and wild, enjoy the ride, we made.
Good evening, everyone, and welcome to another edition of Talking Dogs with Ante. Another
one
which is going to be done here on the beautiful Croatian coast. As you can see, we have this beautiful sunny background, which I suppose some of you are jealous of. And I can really tell you it's really wonderful to be on the coast these days, even if it is very stressful, because, as you know, we are preparing the split summer shows for the next week. And with the things changing from one day another, I am quite sure that maybe we are not going to have a lot of more editions of Talking Dogs with Ante, because I will end up probably in a mental hospital or something like this. But I am really giving my best, and I'm really excited to talk tonight to one of the persons which I really admire, because she is in every sense of the word a real dog person. And you will find out also why. She had a very interesting life in dogs in every sense, and I'm curious to hear it from the first hand. Good evening, Annika. How are you? I'm very happy to see you.
I'm here. Hello. Nice to see you. Welcome to my living room.
Well, yeah, welcome to Rogoznica. Yes. As I said to you before we started the interview, I really hope that, even less than 1 week from now, we are going to be together at this place, so you can enjoy a little bit of wonderful view and the summer. Okay, my first question, Annika, for you will not be about directly about the coronavirus, as I normally
Thank
ask,
you.
But it's going to be, are you excited to judge in Split next week?
Of course. When you send me these matches, I thought, is it true? Really true? Second time,
yes.
I was very happy, and I think the message back was just happiness.
Yes, absolutely. Yes. But tell me another thing. I mean, in these crazy times that we are passing, are you a little bit worried about all this traveling by plane, changing the planes, airports, or this? Or you just think that we should, in a way, continue with the life?
For me, we have the life a bit like normal at home. We live in the countryside. I do my shopping. I go with friends I know. And we don't have to be afraid for everything.
Yes.
So
yes. I think
be careful. Keep distance.
No kissing, no hugging.
Need to hug everybody.
Yes, exactly. Yeah, I think we all need to, in a way, to learn to live with it and take the best out of it, because nobody is promised to live forever. So why to waste time sitting at home if we can still meet friends with all the restrictions and the safety instructions that we have. Anyhow, we have already some messages, of course, and a lot of people watching. We have hello, Annika and Ante from Birgitta Hasselgren. Hi, Birgitta. We have hello, Annika from Richard Hellman. Missing you, Annika, from Anna Sabo and from many other people. But of course, before we start with all that, I want to ask you one thing. You told me that you were showing dogs about 1 week, 2 weeks ago with the masks and everything. How was this new experience? I mean, was it so different?
Of course it was very different, because it was a limit open show. I brought out two young dogs just to see if I succeeded in socializing and lead training. And it was close by, because we're not allowed to travel that far.
Okay.
And we have a restriction in that as well. And at least that time we had. It was 42 people
with
dogs allowed in the showground at the time, because the rest was people from stewards and thefts. So 50 people together. And then we have a small card coming in, and when this red card was empty, the showground was full.
Okay.
And when you're ready, you had to leave. And if you was best of breed, you got another card to come back 3 o'clock. Finish 11, come back 11. No, the 3 o'clock for the groups are best in show.
Yeah. I mean,
and everybody had a mask on, and the judges, stewards, everybody. And that was open show with not the normal people from open shows. It was mostly professional breeders.
Dog people, yeah.
Curious to go out and show the young dogs.
Yeah. I mean, this is the point. Like, in a way, as you said, we need to be careful and we need to follow the instructions. But we need to find a way to continue one way or another. So let's hope everything will be fine. Okay, let's start a little bit as usual with the past. I want to go back about what it is 60 years ago or something like this.
I'm that old.
when you were just a small little girl.
Yeah.
And because I read that the Wisborne Kennel was established in the early 60s. Yes, and it was established in Norway by your husband Harald.
Yes.
First of all, my first question will be, why Wisborne? What does it mean?
You have to ask him, but he was 16 years that time, but to play Wisborne was a game.
Okay.
That was to play Wisborne. That was, I've been told, and it was far before I met him. He was just 16 years old when he got the prefix and start breeding.
Yeah.
He was the youngest chairman in the breed club anytime in Norway.
Okay, so we need to believe him that it was a game. And we take it that way.
To play Wisborne, we think so.
Okay, but I mean, once when you both connected in this Wisborne story, and if we look today, Wisborne has produced 170 champions. Is that a good number?
Plus.
Okay, this I would say that was a very very successful combination. Definitely. Tell me, Annika, Wisborne started with collies. This is something that I found out, smooth and rough collies. Was it that at the time when only Harald was having the kennel, or you got already involved when the collies were there?
I met him through the collies. I was in school with a girl that had the collie and the Afghan. and crazy young dog people traveling to England in this small Volkswagen.
Yes.
Yeah, this really small one. And then it happened to be Harold and the late Kari Schoenfeldt that died many years ago suddenly, and this Toril. And she came back with an Afghan puppy. Not a clue what to do with this puppy because she was in school, sister in school, and mommy working, living in a flat in Oslo. And
yes,
a puppy should be difficult, an Afghan puppy double trouble.
Yes,
I agree. That time we had no dogs, no animals at home at all. But my mother said, okay, I'm at home, I can maybe help them. So she took care of this Afghan. And when she was ready, she moved back. And next summer, these crazy idiot young people went to England again.
Okay.
And she came back with a Rockaby Rough Collie male.
Okay.
My mother said she was missing a little bit this to have a dog. So she said, maybe we can take him. So that was the beginning. He came by air to the old airport in Oslo. Harald was there. Young, handsome man. I started to travel around showing this dog and made him up a champion. I was totally without any experience. And the rest is history.
Yes. Yes.
2 years later, 50 years ago this year.
Oh, that's a nice number. Congratulations.
It's a nice number, yes.
Yes, congratulations to both of you. I know how difficult it is to keep this relationship so for a long time. So 50 is really amazing number. So well done to both of you. It takes a lot of love and a lot of understanding and a lot of good things and bad things to come to these numbers. I think it's amazing.
A lot of understanding, at least.
Absolutely. Yeah. Absolutely. And a lot of compromise. That's always a key. Okay, so you mentioned these collies, and you mentioned that all this was happening in Norway. You met Harald, you got married, you continued to have dogs. At what point did you move to Sweden?
Oh, I'm born in Sweden, actually.
Ah, you were born in Sweden.
About 100 years ago, but I lived here till I was 7.
You look good for 100 years, I can tell you this.
Because you told me in the CV that I started showing when in 1950. I thought, okay, I'm 90. Yeah,
Francesco discovered that
yeah,
was a mistake.
Yeah, that's just fun. And I was there. It was a lot of these young, upcoming people that time. That Margaret Weir with that racketeer poodles, Geir Flick Pedersen, that time just a young boy that was traveling with Harald to England. Bought some cockers and come back home, start grooming. And we had a lot of fun together and we learned a lot from each other. And I at least learned a lot from these people that already was in the dogs. So, we lived in Norway for many years, many, many years. But I had a very, very hectic life. I had 3 boys. Growing up, we have the dogs. I was showing, I was judging, I was working more than full time. Mm-hmm. So I was just running. And I thought, I have to stop or die.
Yes.
So we find this house in the countryside in Sweden. And I moved here.
Yeah.
Which
year that was, more or less?
It's, it's in September 30 years ago.
Okay, so you are 30 years living in Sweden.
Yes.
Tell me, Annika, at some point after the collies came the American and English Cocker Spaniels, if I follow well the chronology of the breeds. How did that happen?
Everything in my life happened just by accident. But we went to England just before we married. And together with Margaret Weir, with the standard poodles, she had she was on the way to buy this Leander Midnight Cowboy. And as you know, I was not really a dog person. I was just following to Windsor. And I walked around there and I stopped with the American Cocker Ring. And I thought, that's something for me. I like them, but I don't like that dog. I like that one. And then they was laughing. I said, that's the first American champion coming to England. So forget about him. It took me 6 months. I had him.
Yeah.
Okay. He was a very special dog, a great show dog. He learned me a lot of grooming. That time we had no big dryers, just a small hand dryer. It took me 5 hours. Today, I should judge him. I should give him at least 0.
Okay.
On size and quality of coat. He was big like a horse. He had coat like wool.
Poor guy, he's turning around in his grave now.
And
he says, I was so good to her and now she's telling this.
That he learned me a lot of grooming. Yeah, yes. The hard way.
Yes. And then you had the American Cockers for some time.
Yes. It was very difficult that day because it was a very small breed. Very, very few of them. If I wanted to have what I really liked, I had to buy them from America. That time in quarantine, we bought in 4 or 5 dogs from America. Some came out of quarantine after 4 months, cost us a fortune. We have to put them down because there was blinding cataract.
Oh, jeez.
It was a lot of trouble with whelpings, bad mothers, screaming puppies, dying puppies. So I was fighting totally alone with the breed because nobody else was working that day. So yes. In the end, I was feeling beautiful show dog, but no.
Too much trouble.
Too much trouble. It was not the breed you with the nice heart and open mind can sell to pet people.
Yeah.
Because it should be problems. So that's why I quit it. I started my career winning second best in show after this Leander Midnight Cowboy at the big international show in Norway. And the last dog I was showing from my breeding was Whisper Man Style. I just sold him, but I showed him under late Bob James.
Mm-hmm.
And he was best in show at the Kennel Club show in the same place I started.
Yeah. That was the nice end, yes. Yes.
Yeah. And then,
of course. And what was with the English Cocker Spaniels? You also had some of those.
Yeah, a very short time because Harold was more fond of those because they had less coat and he liked his forest walk and that was not for the Americans.
Yeah,
but that time it was too much trouble with the red cocker and temperament. So, no.
Yeah, of course. I mean,
but then Harold wanted a sporty dog for his forest walks and he bought English Springer.
I want to talk later on a little bit more about the Springers and about other breeds that let's say have stayed till now almost with you. But quickly, I want just to pass through some of the comments that we have. Let me see. We have hello from Galivare, from Anna-Lena Nilsson, Bruce Jenkins. Hello from South Africa. Federico Sanguinetti, hello Annika and Ante, Juan Rivera, hello from Montevideo, Tina Westerinen, hello from Finland, Tanja Hoff, hello from Germany, Johan Sandstrom, hi Annika and Ante, Siv Hilde Ovare, hey Annika, beautiful as always, Monika Michalowska, hello from Poland, then hello from Iceland. Well, look this now, Anders Rossell, hey Annika. Manga fantastiska historier med Sakerhet, Kramer Fran Oss. I don't know what did I read. And probably you didn't
understand. Fantastic histories, hugs from us.
Ah, wonderful. Okay, so I managed to read it.
He was a small boy following some of the American Cockers, yes.
Wonderful. And then we have, yes, hello from Austria, from Maria Luisa Doppelreiter, Ramon Podesta, hello from Chile, Dan Erickson saying happy to hear Annika, and many others writing. So I'm happy that a lot of people are watching this interview, because definitely there are a lot of interesting things that we are going to pass. But okay, as I said, we are going to go a little bit more in deep with your main breeds. But I want to pass just quickly, because I think that in your life, the fact that you have changed a breed from different groups and so on has probably helped you incredibly a lot to become later on a judge, to understand different breeds, how they function in a different way, temperament, way of approaching them and everything. So I read there was also a short affair of Harald and you with the Irish soft-coated Wheatons and with Boxers.
Yeah, very short. Our oldest son wanted his own dog, and he was saving his own money, and he bought this Boxer male. Mm-hmm. I was showing him. He lived in our house, and he was winning a lot, that dog. Andrew Brace gave him CIC from junior class at Sjølis that day in Norway, mm-hmm, at the kennel show. We lost him very early because he went very sick. Suddenly, he was 3.5 years old. We have to put him down. He was missing one CSCIB for his international title. He had this mental test on higher scores, and he was winning group placements, a lot of best of breed. He was best of breed under Hans Lettin at Stockholm Show. 80 boxers.
Yeah, at that time there were many.
He was a beautiful dog, but not the most healthy dog.
Yeah, that's unfortunately problem in many breeds. And the Irish soft-coated Wheaton Terriers?
It happened, I only had two. It was a friend in Sweden that brought in a male from America, and she wanted me to show him in Norway, mm-hmm, and groom him and do this, and we was winning a lot. He was runner-up top terrier in Norway that year. I maybe created a little bit new style on him, and I remember one show that Rainer Wuren came up and told me that you don't need to do this and make this breed different.
Yeah.
And as a present for showing him that much, I got a female, and she was also winning a lot, but she could not be in with other dogs. She was moving to a family, and she was working in the elderly house the last couple of years of when she was alive. But these two dogs learned me what coast not should be in that breed.
Yeah, because
beautiful Uli Wooly things.
Yeah, we are going to talk about this, because I think you are a perfect person to talk about different styles of grooming and coats and types and everything. And we are going to start soon with that. Last breed of this, let's say, breeds that have not been bred on a big basis by you or everything that you were showing, were the Portuguese water dogs.
Yeah, I happen to breed 1 liter. One puppy.
Oh, okay.
I had a female from America that I showed here in Europe. Mm-hmm. We should mate her. And then I find this male in Canada that I thought should be a nice match for her. So it happened that he came here as well and stayed for a while. I had this litter, big litter.
Yes.
I showed her a lot. She was an unbeaten female from the first show she was in. But it's a beautiful breed. But my God, in my age, they need 2 hour exercise. They need brain work, and they need all the coat work.
Yes. Because
that was a lot.
Yes. I don't know if it's going to sound that I'm old or that I'm young, but I can remember you showing Portuguese water dogs. So that has already been in my time. So that's not such a long history. That was not a long time ago.
This female moved to Norway to Aqua Forest Kennel, and she's today mother of two gold winners and the Kraft winner.
Wonderful.
Yeah.
Wonderful. Okay, we have also Peter Friedrich Bertel saying, lovely talk, happy meeting you both soon. Yes, Peter, we all hope that we are going to meet next week in Split. This is a kind of a dream. Okay, now we are going to one of the first breeds where I want to talk a little bit more with you about. And this is because of all these differences and things, because you mentioned you have been buying dogs in the States and you have been buying dogs in England, and you were trying different styles of grooming on different dogs and everything. And I mean, I think this is in a way the best way to learn the things, and gives you, as you can see, gives you a completely another impression of what we were doing in the past and how we would do it today. But it's this amazing process of learning. I want to talk a little bit about Shih Tzus. I know you had this dog that you brought from Canada, Connor, I think was his name.
Yes.
And when I have these presentations about grooming and handling and everything, on one of my slides, I also have two pictures of Connor. One when he was winning Best in Show somewhere in Canada with his huge top knot on his head. Mm-hmm. And then another one of him winning Best in Show with you somewhere, I think, in Norway or somewhere without anything on his head, just brushed down and so on and so on. And I always ask people, do you see the difference? And they say, yes, because he has this and that. But not many people, only because of the fact of grooming, can really at first say it is actually the same dog.
Yeah. So,
my first question is for you. I know that when you had this Connor, there has been people who thought that he was amazing dog, and then there were people who were talking that he was a little bit far too much American in type. When we talk about Shih Tzus and about the type, what actually it is, where do we find these dogs? Are these American dogs or Latin American dogs so different than the dogs in Europe?
Totally another breed. Connor was not an American Shih Tzu, to be honest. I saw that dog first time he was 6 months old. I was judging in Canada. And I just had this amazing puppy on the table, a little crazy puppy. The handler had a wig on because she had cancer. He grabbed her wig and was shaking it on the table. I was a little bit, oops, as you say. She put the wig on. I say, nobody, I don't care. Everybody know I have a wig.
Yeah.
So, amazing dog and nothing more. And then Dan Eriksson was there judging a national and gave him Best in Show and came back and say, I had an amazing Shih Tzu, not American at all, beautiful. That should be something. 2-3 days later, I had a call from Canada and they say, the owner died in cancer same week and he won this Best in Show. And the last wish was that he should be shown somewhere else. He was top 10 all breeds in Canada. And I say, why not? I'm crazy enough.
Yes.
So I say, let's go. We do it.
Yeah. Yeah. And, so and
that was the big surprise when he arrived here in his first show.
Yeah. And I mean, you had this people who were thinking he was a little bit too much, and then people who were thinking he was just perfect. This is what I want to ask you. When we talk about the type in the Shih Tzu, what it is that is so different among the, let's say, the European dogs and the American dogs?
The proportions, height on legs, the big body they have in Europe, and we want to have them. The big bones, they are too slim, high on leg, short in body, long neck, small head. In America, we need them low on leg, strong body, big head with big open eyes, with the jaw and not this small dolly face.
Yeah. And when we talk about these two types, do you think that there is even if obviously in Europe we have the type which is compared to the FCI standard, do you think that there is something that Americans have good about this breed that could probably improve the breed in Europe?
The temperament only.
Yeah, the temperament, yes. That's also important yeah. part for a show dog.
Yeah,
definitely.
Yeah, but
okay.
It's two different breeds, totally different.
Yeah.
But Connor was not that American. He was really producing a lot of beautiful puppies here.
Yeah.
And he was top of the breeds in Norway.
Yeah, I remember. I remember you did really, really well under him. With him, I want to ask you when we are on the Shih Tzus, I want to ask you about this grooming, because there has been a lot of controversy about that, and I know that the English have put now these new things in the standard saying that there should not be a bow and so on. I mean, how do you look at that? Is it such an important thing for a dog the way how you brush the hair on the head? What
of
it is
course,
about.
If you can make the head you look much, much nicer with the proper made top knot. Not put the rubber band back on the skull and just let it fall like a frog on the head.
Okay.
Yeah.
So
because if a beautiful head, you need to build up a little bit with the big head fall, the big mustache, to really show the nice head and expression. And you do it with top knot.
Okay, so for
a little bit of plush hair and.
Yes. So yeah. For you, a top knot and a bow, it's a yes for you.
I can go without the bow if it's a nice made top knot, but not an American top knot.
So it should be something
in between. Normal top knot, yes. Not 10 rubber bands.
Yeah. So it should be something in between.
Yeah,
but this is usually, I always say to the people, compromise is usually always the best solution.
Yeah.
Not one thing, not another, but something in between. Tell me, Annika, we will stay just, I think I have only one more question about the Shih Tzus. And that's because we talked privately, you and me, about this some years ago. You judged the breed at the European show in what it was, in Norway. What it was, where it was the show? Yeah, in Norway. Lillestrøm, yeah. And you said it was very difficult for you. You said the dogs were very mixed in type, and when you finished judging, you had two dogs that people, maybe from outside, also because of the way of grooming, were thinking were different. But you said when you have put your hands on them, that was not the case.
No.
Can you tell me a little bit about that?
Yeah, of course, the way of grooming and presentation make a big difference. In the end, I had a female I really adore. She was not in condition. She had a top line like, we say, a ski jump after three times around the ring. But she was still a fabulous Shih Tzu. And then the male was slightly different, but well-built. If I should prepare him myself, he should look very European. And he could move like.
Yeah, because I mean,
they're going, but still a Shih Tzu.
Yes. Yeah. But how difficult, I mean, you have judged all around the world and on all the continents. How difficult is to find yourself in one of these breeds? Like, and I think you have a soft spot with the breeds which are difficult. Like Springers and like Shih Tzus. How difficult is to judge when you get a lot of dogs and then you get a little bit dogs different in type, but then of course some dogs are much better in one point and another. How difficult is that to find, let's say, something in between that should please everybody?
It depends where in the world you are. You have to take the tradition a little bit where you're judging them.
Yeah.
It's one breed I refuse doing in America, and that's English Springers.
Yeah.
I will never, ever do it, because for me, it's nothing to do with the breed. In the other breeds, we can find dogs that still suit our taste and a medium way in the standards.
Yeah.
Because the American standard is not that different.
this is the thing. I don't know with who I was talking. I think maybe even with Jorge Nalem or somebody. I was asking, I said, like, these American springers and English springers from Europe and from the UK, they look so different. And I asked, should they really at some point become two different breeds? And he was saying that it's not necessary, because actually the standards itself are not too different. They're not many, but when you look at the dogs, they are completely different.
It's really not the same breed. The same as the Shih Tzus. The most extreme Shih Tzus in America is another breed.
Yeah. And do you think that at one point these breeds should just be divided and not called the same name? Because in a way, really, I think that if you look at an English Springer Spaniel, for example, in Sweden and in America, are two different breeds, but they have the same name.
They have the same name, yes. I think it's a bit difficult to separate them, because then people will go more for the flashy dogs and they will forget about the real type.
Yeah.
Because people want the show dogs.
Yeah, many times.
Suddenly, because too many people today just want a quick moving, flashy show dog. Yeah. They have seen the real top dogs in the breed.
Yeah. Tell me, Annika, you have been breeding Springers for a very long time, and you had incredible success with the breed. Why did you stop breeding them?
Yes, it's different reasons, but yes, we had a lot of success. 4 world winners, we won the group in 1 world show. We have some dogs that really background in some of the very successful kennels these days that we're very proud of. We still have the top stud dog bred by us in the breed history in Europe. We're getting older. We're getting older. And these breeds needs a lot of exercise. They need brain work, again, like the Portuguese. Sometimes I just feel bad that I was working full day. I didn't have the energy to do what I should do. Yeah. So this bad and then one thing more, that the breed was changing a bit in type and style, and after a while I was thinking and looking around and say, what in hell I should use on my females?
Yeah.
So I said, enough is enough, we stop on top. And our last female died last year, nearly 14-year-old, and that was the end of it. And then Harold wanted just his pet dog, and he got this nice beagle.
Yes, I saw that you have a beagle and you are also bringing it to the shows. But going back to the Springers, when you look at the breed, what would you say that it is, let's say, the main characteristic of the breed? And in the same way, you said that one of the things that was bothering you in the breed is that the breed was changing. So going on that subject, because you judge them quite often, what do you think that at the moment is the biggest problem in the breed?
I think I'm quite happy to see the breed is coming back to what we used to have some years ago. It was for some years low on leg dogs. It was different, quite difficult to see who was the male, who was the female. It was just quick moving dogs. The quicker, the better.
That's in many breeds.
And yeah, they should be the highest on leg of the land spaniels. And they had no legs.
Yeah. And you said
no bone, they had snipey faces, yellow eyes. But the quality is really coming back. I was doing an open show for the Springer Club recently, and I was very happy about it. And next year I will do 100-year jubileum for the English Premier Club in England.
And oh, that's nice.
Very, very honored about that.
Yes. Yeah. Well, that's a great assignment. And I mean, I suppose there are still really good springers in the UK, but I think that also Scandinavians are doing a very good job.
We have some very high quality in Scandinavia. Yes, both in Sweden, Denmark, even quite a few in Poland and Finland.
Yeah.
The quality is really, really high. And the top winners on all the big shows coming from up here in Scandinavia.
Yeah, yeah, that's a great thing. You mentioned that Harald wanted to have a pet, and he got a beagle. Did you want a pet? Did you want a pet, and then you got the Dandy Dinmonds?
But I never do something just normal. I have one, but I have six now.
Six you have already?
Yeah, yeah. Four adults and two super nice puppies.
I want to ask you
2 liters.
Yes, I want to ask you about the dandies, because I would think that's definitely not an easy breed in many ways, and it's constructed very much differently than many other breeds. How difficult they are to breed and actually to understand.
Yes, why do it easy?
Yeah, exactly.
I like to make it a bit difficult for myself. It happened that I met this lady with the Darien kennel in Thailand. And I thought, it should be nice to maybe have one of your dog just for a short time, because it's a different way of grooming.
Exactly.
Different dog and so. So this male came to me and he was just going under my skin, and he should go back to Russia from Amsterdam. And my sister came here and she said, this ugly dog, what do you need him for? After 2 hours she said, such a nice dog.
Yeah.
So she said, okay, you need one when I visit, you need to have one. So I bought a female. But yes, of course, he went back to Russia 2 weeks, and then he said, no, I want to go back to Annika. So he's my bed bug.
Yeah. But this is a funny thing, because I can understand this, because when you say, when your sister saw it for the first time, she said, what an ugly thing this is. And I mean, we had the same thing with the Affenpinschers, you know.
Yeah. Yeah.
When we saw them at the first time, we said, who wants to have this at home?
Yeah.
Like, why would you want to have? And then you find so much charm in this, strange breeds, and they get really, like what you say, under your skin, and you cannot imagine. So dandies are going to stay for a while in a Ulltveit-Moe family.
I think I hope I'm able to make at least a few generations.
Yeah, that would be nice.
It's so funny, and of course it's difficult, because finding males for my females. I use my old male now, but next time, I find one male in Thailand, one in Ukraine, one in Czech Republic, one in England.
It's actually quite a small breed.
It's a small breed genetic, yes.
Yeah, yeah. And what about...
Actually, it's very small.
Yeah, and what about grooming? Is it very difficult?
What's difficult?
Well, I don't know.
If you do it once a week, it's not difficult.
Yeah.
Then you can keep a colt rolling. Of course, but our dogs live a very free life. They exercising a lot, and of course they need bathing and brushing the top knots and the bears and all the underwear. And then I strip out a little bit from the jacket once a week, then they always look nice. It's some work, yes.
Yeah, yeah, of course.
Compared with the last one.
Now we will cut to that.
Okay.
I suppose that's not the work compared to other breeds. So it's definitely a little bit easier. Anyhow, we have a lot of comments. One of them is from Francesco Focchetti, who is saying Annika is an icon in our dog world. And then when we are on the subject of the Dandy Demons, Dimitri Santanopoulos is saying you should see her new Dandy puppy. Many will talk about it in the future.
Yes, so, she's something.
So
my Caledonia.
Caledonia. And she has a nice name.
Yes.
Okay, we have passed more or less all these breeds. Some of them have stayed longer with you, some of them shorter. But in a way, am I right if I say that actually Lhasas has always stayed your first love and your first passion?
Not my first love, but when they came to my life, they will stay there forever. That's really my heart dog.
Yeah.
Even if I don't have that many anymore, I not breed a lot anymore, but I will always have some coated Lhasas around because I love them in beautiful coats.
Lhasas are definitely...
Of course, I have some in short coats, but it will always be some there, and I just adore the temperament of them.
Yeah, and when you look at the Lhasas as a breed, what would you say that it is, let's say, the main feature of the breed, and what would you say that at the moment is the biggest problem of the breed?
The biggest problem is a lot of big producers that maybe never seen the really top dogs in the history. They have not really a clue about type. The bigger coat, the faster mover, the better.
Mm-hmm. That's a problem.
It's hard to keep the size down, to keep the moderate. Full coat, yes, but it have to be coat that people can manage. And, you know, I was swimming with three of them.
Yeah, I know that. Yeah.
A week ago, that was the most crazy thing.
Well,
6:30 in the morning, 11 degrees in the water. We were swimming and the dogs in full coat, and they came home self-drying and they were not matting up. That means we have to work for quality coats that people can manage.
Yeah, because usually I think the problem is that, for example, on the Lhasas, the real coat, the good coat, the typical coat is not easy to get, so easy to be so long. And of course, the untypical coat is much easier because it grows faster. The real typical coat, it's something completely different. But when you started in Lhasas, and when you compare the dogs at that time, when you started and you compare them now, do you think the breed is better now or it was better before? Is it going in a good direction, or how do you feel about it?
When I got my first Lhasa, it's many years ago, before I moved here, I just happened to drop in the garden for a friend of me that had the male going there. He looked like a big gray thing. And I say, what's this? Oh, that was Trady's nose for news, Super Ted. I say, but this gray thing moves nice. She said, I get in panic, just think of grooming him. Take him if you like. So I took him in the car and went home. I start grooming. 3 shows later, he was best in show at the Kennel Club show in Norway.
He
was a beautiful dog that day. Today he should be very normal. He had some sisters. That was not that flashy, not that showy. One of them was even best in show at the international show, but they had the size, they had the heads and expression, they was Lhasas in temperament with the proudness and the way they carried themselves. Was not the big winners. He was the big winner, but he was not the best dog.
It happens many times.
That day, I learned the breed through Jeff Corrish and Gene Blight and Fresno. And it's quite sad that even today, Fresno is some of the best.
Yeah.
And it's very sad because most of the breeders today never seen her live. They have never seen this quality. They haven't seen that type.
Yeah, this is a problem in many breeds, and I know that many people in many breeds say, unfortunately, that the quality was better some 20, 30 years ago, and that's in a way very sad, because we would really like in many breeds to say the quality is much better down now than it was before, but yes, it's not so easy. So you think that the breed at the moment, and here we have also a question from Slobodan Asteski saying size is the biggest problem, I think. What do you think? Except of the size, what do you think that the Lhasa people should start to think about if they want to get back on a good track with the breed?
Size, quality of coat, expression. Size of eyes and the chin.
Yes. Yes, because that's...
They have no expression anymore. Big round eyes, broad skull, no chin.
Yeah, and that just talks a lot about many breeds that at some point, and I don't know how that happens, they just lose this one thing which is so important for the breed, and once when you lose it, it is so difficult difficult to get it back, but yes, it's something that we all need to work on. Dan Erickson is saying, ask her about the bitch she had from Italy that I loved.
He don't even, not even him, not only him. She was the queen of our house, and it was Dana, and of course it was Nashua.
Yes,
it's the females he's thinking about. They was something special.
I agree.
I know, been with you for a long time, and she was the princess of the house, and Dana was the queen.
Yes, yes. Najwa was actually the reason why I have fell in love with the breed. Mm. And I mean, we lost her just a year ago, but I mean, she was really special. Mm. She was really special. And
I was this as well. Yeah.
Yes. Sometimes you get these dogs that. That in a way stay in your heart forever.
Yeah.
That's for sure. What it is? Wait. Javier is sending hearts now when we are talking about Najwa.
Yeah.
Let me see this because I'm trying to catch one comment, but I'm not sure if I have missed the first part saying. Eva Hjeltborg saying, I did not say Tak was ugly, but very different from anything I had seen before. He turned out to be the nicest character ever and melted our hearts. Regards from Oslo.
That's my sister.
Ah, that's your sister.
Yeah.
because you know, I read the message and I was not sure which, did I miss a little part of it?
No,
but
no.
Now when you say it, sister,
she's the reason I bought the female as well. Yeah.
Now I can understand what it is about. It's about the dandies. Yes. Okay. Let's. I think we have talked now a little bit about all the breeds that have passed through your life. And I read quickly here one comment about from somebody something about if we are having for interviews only the judges and so on. We usually have the judges who are also breeders because, as you can see, we talk much more about breeding strategies than about judging, and it's all the time like this. Anna Sabo is asking, ask Annika if she has been lately swimming in the lake. I think, Anna, you have missed a part of the story. She was saying she has really enjoyed swimming in the lake with you. And we all know that you, even if your photos are fantastic, you take out the worst out of people and you make them do really crazy things. So
yeah.
Annika was obviously one of your victims.
TikTok in the morning.
Yeah, I can imagine. Let's do now just a few quick questions, and then we are going to continue with other subjects. These are the ones that people usually find quite difficult to answer, but I'm sure you are going to manage. Best show you ever judged?
Oh my God!
Or one show that you have judged and you will never forget?
I think the quality I had in the European show when I was doing some of my heart breeds. But I've been doing so many nice shows.
Yes, this I know. Tell me, if you would need to choose only one breed of all the breeds that you had in your life, so Lhasa, Springers, Dandies, whatever, which breed you would say it's your favorite?
I have to say the Lhasas.
The Lhasas.
Yeah.
Okay, so you stay with your heart.
Yeah.
I
have a treated heart.
Yeah, I can imagine that. One best in show lineup that you will never forget.
Oh my God, that's a very different and difficult question, because I haven't done best in show in this very important shows, but if it does have to be best in show, I think the group 8 at the European show was great experience. Yes. So many wonderful dogs.
Yes.
It don't have to be best in show to be great, but that group was something special for me.
Yeah. Tell me.
Okay.
Yes, that's perfectly fine. I will take it as a correct answer. Tell me, before we continue, we have a question from Lee Stanholm Kalismar. Is there a Lhasa now today that she likes? But I think you should not say that, because maybe one day you will judge it. And
many.
Whatever.
It's many.
Yes.
Yeah, it's several.
Yeah.
I can find the nice dogs several places. And
that's good.
Yeah,
I think that's a better answer than to go into details. Yeah.
It's not more specific.
Yeah. Tell me a favorite Springer of all times, not bred or owned by you.
Not owned and bred.
Yes, one Springer you have seen or judged that you...
Absolutely, totally stupid about names, but Seeger Kennel in Denmark had a female that won Kraft. I don't remember her name, but I could give my arm to have her in the house.
Yes, okay.
A female. Springer.
That's a nice compliment, definitely. And the Lhasa?
Not bred or own. It have to be Fresno.
Yeah. Many have said that the same answer.
Yeah. Hackensack was the big winner, but he was not my favorite.
Tell me, Annika. I know it's also not an easy question, but if you would think now, what was the best dog that you have ever bred?
Ooh. The best overall dog, or the best dog? I should say the best overall dog,
by your measures,
remember, from all over the world, have to be Whispering Devil in Disguise.
Which breed it was?
English Springer.
Okay.
He was something special. He been father of 48 champions. More than 50% had the working title for the championship. He had the working title himself. He won the group at the World Show. Top stud dog.
Yeah, that's amazing record. If you think, what would be the favorite win with your own dogs?
Ooh.
And there have been many.
It's been many. To be a little bit controversial.
Okay.
Yeah.
I like that.
I was showing this Shih Tzu in Sweden. He should arrive here 2 weeks earlier, but it was something wrong with the paperwork, so he couldn't go. So he arrived the night before my dog show in January. I have to pick him up in Copenhagen, came home with him, bought him, and showed him. It was more than 80 Shih Tzus. I had not a clue about the breed judge. I couldn't tell anybody about his coming, because Dan Eriksson should do the group, and Göran Bodegård, bless him, should do best in show. Both had given me best in show in Canada a few months before. Mm-hmm. So I was just silent. I arrived there with the dog. I had him by the lasso ring, and people was looking on this short face thing. Sorry, it's not a lasso. So, and the Shih Tzu people so stressed and say, oh, it's a lasso, that's wrong in the catalog.
Yes.
So, I just brought him there, put him down. I was not brave enough to have him in open, so I had him in champion class. It was a huge entry of Shih Tzus, and he was best of breed. And I went to the pre-judging ring. I remember Dan Eriksson's face when I put him on the table, and he took his muscles like this, and he said, how old is this one? I said, he's 4-year-old. Bloody lady, it's one of these in the world. Yes, it is. And then we had a change of judge in best in show.
Yes.
So Göran had to go home because he should go by train, and Agnieszka Nami was doing best in show. And this poor dog, he was so tired and so jet lagged, but he was that show dog. So when I asked him to go, he was doing it, and he won best in show.
Yeah.
And the thing was, I was scheduled to do best in show that day, but things happened. I was not.
Okay. Yeah, yeah, well, that's a lot of controversy in one story. Okay.
So that was a quite, and my husband said, that was a bloody shit you won this match. Now you have to show him the whole year.
Yeah.
He was top dog in Norway, number 4 in Sweden, and number 5 in Denmark that year.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah, that I can understand this answer perfectly. Tell me, Annika, and this is maybe something that is going to be very interesting from Harald. For Harald, one breed that you never had at home but you would like to have.
My dream since I was a little girl is the Scottish Terrier.
Oh.
That has never happened. So
Maybe it can happen. Maybe it can happen soon. I think that Dan and I can work on that a little bit.
I used to say, when I'm really old, I want one Scotty.
Yes.
That's it.
Well, that's a nice breed to choose, that's for sure. Okay. One dog person which is not alive anymore and you terribly miss.
It have to be Britta Rosbergesson and Hans Lethin.
Yeah, two wonderful people. Okay, if you think, Annika, of one breeder that always impress you with the quality of dogs, doesn't matter which breed it is, and you see their dogs year after year, judging them or just seeing them, doesn't matter, and you would say that's one breeder that always makes an impression on me with the quality of his dogs, can you name one person from Sweden and one person from the rest of the world?
May I only take one?
You can take also one, yes. It's okay for me.
Only one?
Yes. Yeah,
because in Sweden, we're not able to just mention one.
Ah, okay.
We really have to take some. We have to take the 2 flat-coated retriever breeders.
Okay.
That really doing the world with the dogs.
Okay.
They're fighting a lot together, but I think that's a good thing for the breed as well. And yeah, they have big quality on the dogs.
That's for sure.
So
and
we
from the rest,
take the flat coats.
Yeah. Oh, and from God. The rest of the world?
Oh, my God. It's so many.
Well, one or two.
I think we take a Bitter with Sobers.
Sobers, yes. Bitter in Italy. Now yeah. In Italy, yes.
Now in Italy, because yeah. she. Year after year after year, and she really put a stamp on the breed.
Yeah,
and not only the grails.
Tell me, Annika, if you think of judges who are still active, one person that always impressed you with their with his or her style of judging and the knowledge about the dogs, one from Sweden and one from the rest of the world.
You're not kind.
I'm not kind. I'm famous for not being kind.
I want to take two names then in Sweden. Because this is people that you always can talk about dogs, you can discuss, you can have a lot of feedbacks. It's more passionate than Dan Eriksson.
Okay, and from the rest of the world?
Oh my God. It's many, many, many.
I can give you two.
Take Karriärvinnen.
Okay. And if you want, I give you one more.
Okay. Espen.
Espen. Okay, perfect. Only two more difficult questions. you are organizing your last dinner.
Yeah.
Which five persons you are going to invite?
I should invite Dan Eriksson because he really enjoys nice food.
Okay.
I should take Stefano.
Okay. He has just fried 3 minutes ago. Hello.
Take them from all over. I will take you, Palosari. That okay. used to be my kennel boy when he was a little boy.
Okay.
Yes, I will have more person that also enjoy a nice meal and have. She's a lot of fun.
Yes, and one more.
You can come as well.
Oh,
you like nice food.
Yeah, I can. No doubts about that. Just don't ask me to cook, but I love good food.
I can cook. Don't worry.
That's perfect. Okay, and then the last from the difficult questions. One dog that you judged and you will never forget.
So many.
Okay, but one that it keeps.
It's one dog I still remember the pet name on. And it's Dash, the Varmarainer, that won the group under me in Sydney Royal.
Okay.
I still remember the pet name and I still remember that group and that dog that just.
Yeah, sometimes you have this.
This
dog that stays in your mind forever. And
maybe seen better dogs, but he's still there.
Yeah. Anyhow, in between all the comments that we have, Stefano is thanking you for the invitation for the last dinner. So I suppose it's a yes. Okay, now we are done with these difficult questions. We are going to continue with few more, which are I hope are not going to be so difficult for you. You have been a judge, you are a judge, you are a breeder, you are a handler, you are a groomer, not only a groomer of your dogs, you professionally work as a groomer. Which one of these roles you enjoy the most?
Breeding.
Why?
The excitement to see if you succeed in your thinking or making up pedigrees and yeah, just like excitement to see if you succeed.
I don't know why, but it is like I knew that's going to be a question and your answer, because my question, it says, as a breeder, which part you enjoy the most of breeding and what do you find most difficult about breeding dogs?
The most difficult is the long nights wait for the puppies.
Yes.
And all the cleaning.
Yes.
But I have a very nice kennel boy. We haven't to forget about him. He do a big job at home. And he really supporting and make it possible for me to travel.
Yeah. That's very important. And tell me, what do you find the most exciting part about breeding?
See if you succeed.
Yes.
Yeah.
If you made it
really go in and you feel yes, I'm right.
if you made the good decision.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
And well, sometimes you're totally wrong.
Yeah, well, we all are.
Yeah.
This is normal.
It's ups yes. and downs.
Yes. Tell me, Annika, as I said before, you work as a groomer. That's your, let's say, a daily job. And that's, I think, one of the jobs that people don't really take serious enough, or they don't understand how difficult it is to groom dogs. So I want to ask you, how difficult is really that job?
I don't feel it difficult, but it's a hard job. And the pet dogs are the hard work, because they are spoiled, they never still. They are matted, they are dirty, they have long nails, they have dirty ears. You really have to do a big job with them. The show dogs are the easy part. It can be a hard, big job, but the easier part, because people take care another way.
Yeah. And it's nice that you say
poor show dogs, I say poor. No dogs are taken care of that way as show dogs. They are always clean, happy, in exercise. They have to be in muscle condition, coat condition, have proper food, all this.
I'm very happy that you have answered like that, because it is a lot of people who have, let's say, pet dogs who bring them really in bad condition from time to time. And then they say this, what you say, poor show dogs, when actually the truth is completely the opposite.
Yeah.
Anyhow, I can tell you that also Dan has accepted your invitation for the dinner. He says many thanks, and I'm sure you would make all have a great meal. There is no better chef. So tell me what I need to buy for Tuesday in Rogoznica that you prepare a dinner.
Some ham and cheese.
Yes. Okay. But we are coming closer to the end. We are already 1 hour 15 minutes, and I want to go to another subject that has bring a lot of controversy in your life, the same like Connor and everything else. You started judging in 1984. In 2001, you became All Breeds judge. My first question will be, how difficult is to be an All Breeds judge?
Of course, it's difficult, because the day you get the All Breeds, the real education starts, because it's so many breeds, you can even not spell the name on them. And you're supposed to be an expert on them, and we're not. We really have to read the standards, read the books, read about the breeds if we should go around doing it. So it's not an easy job.
Certainly not.
Enjoy. Yeah, you learn a lot. And going around the world doing strange breed in different
strange places,
but a little bit different types, and you're learning so much about it. And the more you're judging, and the more you learn, the more you have to learn.
Yes, and tell me.
You know,
yeah. Tell me how important was for you when you started judging to have this background as a breeder, as an exhibitor, and so on? Because there are judges actually who have never been breeding dogs on a high level, and they still go around and judge and so on. Do you think that your life, which you have completely dedicated to dogs, have helped you to become a better judge?
I hope so. I think I understand people. I understand the bad cars, late night drives, cold coffee in the car, no sleeps, grooming, picking shit. Yeah.
Yes.
Dragging around, putting up tents, all this hard work that goes around the show. And I think you accept more people the way if you know. And you know, the late nights, waiting puppies that die, or all these sad things around.
Yes.
Not all only easy way out.
Yeah, I agree with you, and I think is the best what you say. it helps you to understand better the things, because I think not only about talking about what we are talking now, but in general life, I think that when you try things, whatever you try, then you understand them. If you don't try, then you don't understand them. So definitely that helps a lot.
Grooming and coat work and all the work behind.
Yes. Yeah. And this is why usually people and judges who are breeders themselves, or who are groomers themselves, or have breeds which are difficult, they put a lot of respect to exhibitors when they show dogs in top condition, because they understand how much hard work is behind that story.
That's almost my goal.
Yeah. Mike Koymans is saying, love the honesty of Annika. I think we all love the honesty of Annika.
Why not with me?
Yes. Yeah. You mentioned one of the things, and I want to ask you about this, because that's something that people are talking a lot about. They say, we are so sick and tired of all-around judges. We want breed specialists. All-around judges are all bad judges. They don't know anything. They have 300, I don't know how many breeds. We want only breed specialists. How do you feel about that?
I think a combination should be very good, because the breed specialists point out just small things in the dogs. We more see the whole picture, and that's very important. And of course, it's bad all breed judges, it's bad breed specialists, and vice versa. And we're not experts in all breeds.
And when we
do better job in other, yes. For sure.
And tell me, Annika, when you think about all this. Traveling and driving. I must say this, because I suppose many people know that we are privately also friends. I will never forget you driving from Stockholm to Targu Mureș to Dracula show. I'm not even going to ask how many hours that was in your Volvo with the dogs. Like I want to ask you, did you ever get tired of traveling, of driving, of packing, unpacking, changing planes and everything, or you still feel the same passion?
I feel the passion, yes. And of course, that was the most crazy thing I done in my life. It was about 7,000 kilometers or something. Yes. And I remember, Lacey, you not grooming your dog. So Atlan, I was grooming your Schnauzer and Kerry Blue and whatever. But we had a lot of fun. And
yes.
It was totally crazy, but sometimes we have to do crazy things. But of course, sometimes you're tired of traveling and packing and unpacking, not packing, but unpacking.
Yes, yeah, I know.
That's
I know the feeling.
Coming home and unpack the car.
Yes, I know the feeling. Let me read few of the comments that we got now. Hakan Hall is saying, thank you, Annika, for always helping and answering our questions. You are a true dog person. Susanna, Susanna Johansen saying, Spaniel lady number one, such an honor to hear your wise words. You are a huge inspiration. Thank you. Charlotte Sandberg saying, it's a great pleasure listening to Annika. And then Petru, probably coming back to the story of Dracula, writing, she drove all alone.
Yes, I did. No, yes. Only to Zagreb.
Yes. Yeah, only. Exactly. We were talking just a little bit before about these breed specialists and all-rounders. Do you find more difficult to judge your own breeds, or you enjoy it?
I find it more difficult, but sometimes I enjoy it a lot if I not do it too often. Maybe every second year or something, and in different places to see where the breed standard goes. But I enjoy doing all breeds. It can be enjoyable to do a small specialty out in the forest somewhere with the hunters that... happy with their good or sufficient, as long as they're dog hunting, they are happy.
Yeah, Yeah, that's true.
And they are honest people that love the dogs.
Yeah. Tell me, Annika, when you look, I'm asking you do this not as a judge, but as an exhibitor, because you show a lot. When you look at the new generations of the judges, do you think that, I'm not asking names, but do you think in general among the new young judges, there are people who are going to become legends like some of the people that we know from the past? Or you think the level of
that time is over? We will never see the legends anymore.
Okay, that's not very optimistic.
No, but they will not allow people to be special. Everybody have to be uniformed.
Yeah.
If you're special, you are strange and difficult or something.
Yeah, well, we are all strange and difficult. that's for sure, but yes,
and a bit crazy.
But what do you think we need to change? What do you think it should be done to get back on the track with judges like Hasse or Rainer or Kari or whatever, doesn't matter, people that you know everybody admire, like Paul, Dan, I don't know, many of them, that, you know, are we going to have people like that in 40 years among the young people that we have
of
now?
Of course, I hope so. But I think we elderly people, we need to be more clever to mentor the young ones.
Yes.
Not only push them away, but mentoring. I really try to mentor young people. It's a lot of people coming here and yeah.
And I want to ask you, do you feel that the let's say older judges are not interested to mentor, or you feel that young people are not interested to learn?
Both.
Yes. Okay.
We have some young people that are eager to learn, but some think it's the easy way out.
Yeah.
And they know everything after 3 years.
Yes. Facebook didn't really help about that. I think Facebook has made a lot of problems for all of us.
It's dangerous sometimes.
Yes, definitely. Anyhow, Richard Hellman is writing, all-rounder means well-rounded. There is no judge as well-rounded as Annika. She has excelled in every aspect of the sport as a breeder, groomer, handler, and a judge. You have all my respect. Nice of Richard to write that. Tell me, Annika, favorite breed to judge and most difficult breed to judge?
I don't really have any favorite breeds. I love to do the group 3. I love to do group 5. Some of these primitive breeds are nice. I enjoy most breeds, but the most difficult for me is the big mastinos. And yeah, that's the most difficult.
Yeah, these molos type dogs, I think they're very difficult to understand. That's for sure.
Then you have to use your brain a lot.
Yes.
Yeah.
Which is sometimes not easy.
No. Dangerous sometimes.
Yeah. I want to ask you, Annika, this, and I don't know how easy it's going to be to speak to you about it, but that's definitely something that has been a big part of your judging career. And this has been this last ban from the from the Swedish kind of club when you got away your judging license, and you got it away, let's say, forever. You were banned to judge ever again in your life. First of all, I want to ask you, why did it happen? And second, I want to ask you, how did you accept it and how did you learn to live with it until it has changed? But we will come to that also.
I've lived a long life. I have always go down with head up and feet down, even in the worst war. But of course it was hard, but in the end it was my fault. What can I do? Accept it. A big part of my life was just chopped off, but I still had my dogs, my breeding, and my showing. I've been active in the dog world anyway. So I never thought about it. And I was not myself thinking of going back. But I have to say, from my heart, it was some fabulous friends around that was not only pushing me and keeping my head up, but was pushing behind my back that I didn't really know about. And yeah, these people know who they are. Yeah. And I'm very grateful that in the end it happened that I'm back.
Yes. And I mean, I think, of
but
course,
this year was not the year to come back.
Yeah, that's for sure. That's for sure. You didn't really pick up a good year to come back.
No, but...
Yeah, but you said that, and I mean, you say it now. I don't know for how long you were suspended.
3 years, three and a half.
Yes. It was. You say, but it's okay because it was my fault. Did you think that way 4 years ago, or you just think about it now that it is like this, and that it's a lesson that you had to learn?
Of course, I had to learn the hard way, really hard way. And it was a time of my life that I was very busy. I had a lot of things going around, and thing was just going out of my hand.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. But I think it's amazing. Yeah. It's amazing that a person can say, yes, it was my fault, and of course I know that
myself.
Yes, yeah. I think with all this story, of course you said you have learned it hard way because you got this punishment which was really really very very strong. I mean, to take away your judging license forever. But in another way, I want to ask you, and you have said it already. Did this story learn you actually also how amazing is the world of dogs? How amazing are the people in the dog world? Because I remember when all this story about signing the petition for you to come back as a judge, and in a way, as you said, pressure also by these official channels and unofficial channels to get you back. Did you realize how many friends you had? And not only friends, but how many dog people really respected you and put an effort to help you to get back because they were thinking you have still a lot to share.
I was amazed, and it's really sometime I was feeling heartbroken because it was amazing. I was never thinking about myself that anything special, just Annika from Sweden that tried to do her best in the ring.
I think I really must say that that the amount of support that you have received, and not only, of course, not only from the people that are friends, and not only from the people who you have put up once in your life, but in general from the dog community has been amazing. And I think this is really something special. So since when you are back in the game?
It's nearly a year now, in October.
Okay. There is a person, Marie Kallert, saying, so happy you are back, Annika. Anna-Lena Nilsson say, we all fight for you to get back. As I said, it was amazing the support that you have got.
It's really amazing.
Yes. When you think, Annika, now about all these young generations growing up, and if you would need to give them one advice, how to become successful in the dog sport, doesn't matter as a breeders or as judges or handlers, groomers, whatever, what do you think would be the best advice to give them?
Work hard. Work a little bit more. Listen to the people you admire. And use mentors that you admire.
Yeah, it is. There are so many people in the dog world from which we can learn many things. And I must say, I started to do these interviews just, I must say, even as a joke, you know, when this Corona times started, and I was thinking, what the fuck I'm going to do home all this time when we cannot go out of the living room. And I'm enjoying it so much because I think it is amazing that we get this kind of possibility to listen to different people, different backgrounds, different opinions, different things, and learn, all of us, you know. And I always say, when you listen to one person, you take from him everything good that you think he can give you, and you just push away everything bad which you don't like. But I think to talk with people like you, like Paul, like Dan, like Espen, like Ramon, and so on, and to have this possibility to change the ideas, to talk about it, I think it's just amazing. Tell me, Annika, I'm sure that that you are one of the persons who follow also this story about this Brahi Brits in Netherlands. And then we are coming to the point, and I'm really sorry because I'm so busy with the split shows that I'm not managing to follow the things as I used before. But I see that the similar story is happening now also in Germany.
In the beginning.
Yes. You don't have any of these breeds, but if somebody, if some government in Sweden would come and say to you, Annika, you cannot breed any more Dandy Dinmonds, and you cannot have pedigrees anymore for them and for the lasses because we think they are not healthy enough, how would you accept it? I mean, how difficult this must be for the breeders of these breeds in these countries?
Of course, it's difficult for everybody that really care for the breeds. And breeds with these small gene pools, they kill the history. Every breed have the history. And why kill it? Because they think of something.
Yes.
You have to be strong. But it will be difficult, and we're just in the beginning. Sorry.
Yeah, I agree. Unfortunately, I agree with you. Okay.
I'm coming.
Yes. Staying on this subject, there will be, now we are almost 1 hour and a half talking, and talking on this, I'm going to ask you just one more question. But before that, I want to read a few more comments, because there has been many, and you will be able to see all of them later. Senja Makinen is saying, thank you, Annika, so lovely to listen to you. Missing often those old times with Springers in the 90s and before Facebook. Agneta Astrom saying, glad you are back. Tim Hilde Ovare saying, Patrick Ovare got his first dog as a present from Annika, Lassa Annie. And he has grown in a successful dog person, so that means something.
He's one of these youngsters upcoming. We have to push.
Yes, in the right direction.
Yeah.
Anna Sabo saying, I personally felt hugely encouraged when I stayed with you. Annika loved our late nights. Yes. Anna loved the late nights, but Annika didn't like the early mornings. I'm sure about that.
Sure. But when I went to bed, she went out walking for 1.5 hours.
Yes, well, okay. Anyhow, we were talking, as I said, more than 1 hour and a half about dogs, about judging, about everything. I have really enjoyed it a lot, and I really appreciate not only that you have accepted to talk to me, but that you have shared your knowledge and your experience, and that you have been so honest about everything. And I'm sure a lot of people share my ideas. Here is our Patrick Ovare saying, big thank you to Annika for everything. You are a remarkable woman. So for our last thought of the evening, tell me, Annika, how do you see the future of the sport? What do you think is going to happen? Where we are going? What we need to do? And is there any way that this is going to continue like this? Are you optimistic or you are pessimistic?
Sorry to say, I'm pessimistic. But okay. I hope I could be optimist. But we see in the top of the dog world and the dog sport. But if we should go back there, I think all this crazy fighting for points and top dogs and all this, take it away. I think that will take it back to another level. Not make groups and best in show the biggest thing in the shows. Go back to breed level. As the Norwegian Kennel Club had the last show, they only had groups. And next show, they will not even have groups. And people was happy about it. And they say, we find out the breed judging was the most important.
Yes. Yes, well, as we know in many things, the problem starts always in the beginning, doesn't start at the end. And the breed judging is actually the beginning, and that's true. Yeah. If that part is not good, then obviously the rest is building up also not to be too good. Anyhow, if you would be optimistic, what would you say is the future of the sport, and how do you see that the things are going to go on in the next 10 years?
That we're able to breed dogs as we want to, not only by statistic and numbers, and be artistic in our breeding, show the world that purebred dogs are healthy, pushing up young people to become great at the great people from the past. If not, we don't see the future. We need the young people that really want to go into this, not the easy way, but the hard way. That's what we used to do.
Yes.
Really the hard way.
Yes, this is what you said. This is what you said. Hard work always pays back. Mm. And unfortunately, a lot of people think that success comes from the air, and that we all go just in the ring, and we just are famous, and we just win or do whatever, and they don't see all the hard work behind. Annika, I'm going to say once again, thank you so much for accepting the invitation to be here with us. It was really inspiring to talk to you, because, as I said, you are one of these few people who all this year never stopped being a part of any part of the game. You have always continued to breed, always continued to groom, always continued to show, and always continued to judge. I wish you a lot of success. I am really hoping everything will stay okay for the next week. And I'm looking forward for you cooking the dinner next Tuesday for me in Rogoznica.
No That's problem. Something...
Okay. Thank you, everybody, for a big number of comments and questions for Annika. I'm sure she will enjoy to listen to it later and to read it all. I'm not sure there will be a show next Wednesday, because it's just a day before the split shows. I will do my best, but if that will not happen, certainly then the week after. Stay safe, everybody. And Annika, I hope to see you in a few days. Thank you so much for this. Good evening to everybody.
Bye-bye.
Bye. See you.
Of course, we see.
Yes, bye. Yes. Bye.